What's up, guys? So today we have Anthony DeVito on, very funny comedian, and we talk about Chris Rock, basically in the 90s, and I think it was a great episode, but at the end, we're having some technical difficulties, and Anthony's mic started to crap out a little, so my apologies for that, but stick through it. I thought it was a very good episode despite that, and I don't think it was for too long, but I just wanted to, you know, send my condolences, my deepest apologies, and I wanted to make sure, because I wasn't sure if it got cut off. I wanted to make sure you guys know to go see Anthony DeVito. He's going to be in the Boston area from January 26th to 29th. The 26th, he is at Laugh Boston doing his one-man show. In Worcester on the 27th, he'll be doing the same thing. So if you Worcester's a closer drive for you, check him out in Worcester or here in Boston at Laugh Boston. And then the 28th and 29th, he's going to be in Foxborough. Just doing straight stand-up. So if I would recommend seeing both, I'd go to Laugh Boston and then to Foxborough on the weekend. But if you're just looking for stand-up, check them out at the Comedy Scene in Foxborough on the 28th and 29th of January. And make sure you go to patreon.com/blindmike. That's where you can support this program and get it a week early. So thanks, guys. Enjoy the episode.
You know, I'm going to give you a history lesson.
We got some dumbass motherfuckers floating around this country.
Start laughing.
And when I do, start fucking.
Also, y'all did some nasty-ass jokes on my ass, too.
Funny jokes and unfunny jokes come out of the same birth.
You fucking guys are unbelievable.
Why are you laughing?
Evening, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Why Are You Laughing? Today, I'm pleased to introduce you to Chris Rock from Saturday Night Live to Bigger and Blacker. And great news, everyone. I'm sorry if it sounds a little different today. Mike, Matt, and Chris, all not here. One brave madman took them all out at once. And so Justin is producing today. And we're graced with the presence of comedian Anthony DeVito. What's going on, Anthony?
Yo, man, what's up? I'm going to switch the mic to the USB mic so I sound better. So.
Oh, crystal clear now.
Yeah,
I love it.
I just realized. I'm good, man. I think I might have a – I'm trying to locate. I think I got something in my teeth, so I'm trying to figure that out right now.
That's good. Well, you're on the right podcast because I would never would have known.
No. No, I know, Mike. You're blind as a bat. But, maybe – I think they're just – they're just black. They're just gray, black teeth now. So, but yeah, man, I'm good, you know?
Well, what's going on? But last time I spoke to you, Anthony DeVito, formerly of the Rad Dude cast, no longer exists.
Yeah, man, I had to jump ship on those two losers.
It's funny now that, like, I'll listen to Greg Stone's show, and it feels almost just like you tried to get rid of Brendan Eyre because you're on every fucking episode, it sounds like.
No kidding. Isn't that right, Mike, that I'm on every episode? And this guy, I haven't seen a dime for that, for my efforts. I haven't
Ridiculous.
Seen not even a shekel or anything. This stingy bastard. He has a kid, then all of a sudden he's the only man in the universe that needs to pay his rent.
Notoriously selfish, Greg Stone. Everyone says.
Oh, my God. Jeez, the scales are so tipped. That guy's never thinking of he's never thought of another person his whole life.
So before we get into Chris Rock, you're going to be in Boston soon, right?
Yeah, I'll be in Laugh Boston doing my dumb one-man show on January 26th. And then I'll be at, I think, Nick's Bar in Worcester on January 27th.
Oh, okay, cool. Awesome. Yeah, so go check out Anthony. Very funny. I saw you at the Comedy Connection a couple years ago. And very, very funny man. So go check out Anthony.
Oh, and, thanks, man.
The one-man show's about your dad, right?
Yes, my dad, who was famously a made man in an organized crime family. And I roughly talk about it for 50 minutes. So just so you know what you're getting into.
It's funny. I was telling you I really liked the podcast you did with Ari Shaffir on Skeptic
thanks.
Tank. And I was excited to hear about all the mafia shit. And then it was basically an hour of Ari talking about, like, political correctness. I was like, I want to hear the mafia shit. Come on, Ari.
Yeah, no, it's weird because I don't know. We could just kind of were talking on that thing. But, like, never know what to disclose on a podcast so that when people come to the show, they're, like, surprised.
Right.
I have no idea how to do this thing. But yeah, no, it's weird because he died when I was a baby. So I don't really have like half of it's kind of me walking the audience through his marriage to my mom and what that's like, sort of like dating someone like that, finding out about him and then like the aftermath of that. And then as me finding out about him as I was just going on through life. So that's kind of the story.
It's a crazy unique, obviously. I've never heard anyone that has that story in comedy. But the other interesting thing I think is, like, we were talking recently about, you know, like Sammy the Bull has a podcast now.
I've heard. Yeah, it's funny.
And Michael Franzese, like these mobsters.
Yeah, dude. Every time I tell, not every time, but lots of times when I tell people, they're like, you got to check out Sammy the Bull's podcast.
Well, what I was going to say is it's interesting to hear from your perspective, because they talk like that. Michael Franzese talks a lot about how the mafia, like, decimated families. Like, there's not a family that made it out well from, you know, the father being in the mafia. So I'm actually more curious about your perspective rather than listening to a guy who legitimately killed people be like, hey, subscribe to my Patreon.
I know, it's interesting, man. Yeah, people will like it, it's very interesting to the turn that they make. It's like, well, now he's a podcaster. It's so strange. But I guess the story kind of picks up, like, I mean, you know, like the spoiler alert, but like, yeah, the end of The Sopranos is like, you know, you don't know if Tony lived or dies. It's a blackout. The, you know, the assumption is that he dies. So my story would kind of be like, okay, like, so let's say that happened. Like, where does the story keep going? Like, what happens to the wife after that? What happens to the son after that?
Right.
So yeah, it's a lot of that. Cause I don't know. I really, you know, I haven't really talked to too many people after shows that have like, it's told me a lot about their perception of the performance, but like, I have had people be like kind of excited that they're like, cause people are so fascinated with the genre that like, then they'll come to the show being like, I'm going to hear a bunch of those stories. And you're like, oh no, man, you're going to kind of hear a widow's tale and a sad boy's life.
The comedy equivalent of a woman staring out the window thinking about her life.
Yeah, it's a little disappointing for people that are like came to the show for action. And
yeah,
I'm trying to have these like revelatory moments.
Well, I think everyone go check out Laugh Boston's a cool location too. So make sure you go down there, check out Anthony DeVito when he's here at the end of January. And I reached out to you and said, I told you about the podcast we're doing and wanted to know if you had anyone you were interested in doing. You threw out Chris Rock. So I'm assuming, and it's funny, when I saw you at the Comedy Connection, I was like, clearly a Chris Rock influence.
I get that a lot. My wardrobe alone, you know, they're like, man, enough patent leather clothing from this guy. Jesus.
But I assume obviously he was a big influence when you were a kid.
Huge, man. I think probably him, George Carlin, and David Cross were the three comedians that influenced me the most as a kid. And I know they're all very different. I mean, I think the commonality probably between all three of them is just like skepticism.
Social commentary. Yeah.
Yeah. In different forms. Like David Cross was like skeptical, but then he was more, I guess, like pinpoint. Like it was more, it wasn't broader topics. It was more smaller things that he like really, I mean, he did talk about religion a lot in The Pride Is Back. So that's not entirely true. But then, you know, George Carlin and Chris Rock, obviously, there's a link there in terms of social commentary. And then,
of course, but it is, I mean, like, you know, I'm joking about you clearly having Chris Rock influence, but when you hear Chris Rock talk about his influences, like, he throws out, like, Woody Allen was a big influence
on
Chris Rock and shit like that. So it's funny, it's a very, like, and I'm never this guy that throws this out, but it's a very, like, subtly racist thing people do. It's like when there's a like any black quarterback, it's like, he's just like Michael Vick.
It's like, oh, not really. Sure, man. Yeah, no.
So immediately it's like, oh, Chris Rock, he's just like Richard Pryor, which it's like, in reality, there are a lot of other guys. He's like, you could make more of a comparison to Lenny Bruce than Richard Pryor.
Oh, 100%, man. I mean, Richard Pryor was, you know, he had some social commentary, but for the most part, he was just completely personal and vulnerable. Like, Chris Rock isn't super duper, like Tambourine, he kind of is a little bit, but like, he's not really super personal and vulnerable. The only thing is they're both black. So yeah, people are just like, man, he's just like, you know, like, man, this guy's a spitting image.
He's like Red Fox.
Yeah. You're like, they couldn't be any more different. But yeah, the Woody Allen influence you were talking about, I forgot when Bring the Pain opens, it opens with these comedy albums that influenced him. So they're like superimposed on the screen. It's like Richard Pryor, Flip Wilson. And then
Cosby's in there.
Yeah, Cosby's in there. And then Woody Allen. It's so funny. You're like, yeah, two out of those six guys are serial rapists.
Well, funny thing is, I was listening to, like, just pulling clips and shit for today's podcast.
Yeah.
I was listening to Chris Rock when he was on Marin a few years ago.
Sure.
And he was telling this story about how, I guess, Cosby contacted Chris Rock. And because of the content that was in there, like Bring the Pain is the one with the famous N-word bit, which I'm sure we'll talk about later.
Yeah.
But Cosby didn't want to be associated with that and told him he wanted the album cover out of the special. So it's hilarious to look back and be like, Bill Cosby was embarrassed to be associated with that.
Yeah. Yeah. But he didn't. I mean, like Eddie Murphy has that like famous conversation with him in like Raw or Delirious where like Bill Cosby's like denigrating him for the foul language. It's just so funny to be like, man, you knew the whole time what you were doing and the gall of you to try to like position yourself as this upstanding citizen all the while knowing what you're doing on the weekends is mind like that takes a certain amount of like disassociation and ego that I can't even fathom a person having.
It was ultimately his undoing because that was Hannibal Buress's bit. I mean, eventually, yeah,
totally, man.
Who knows? Maybe it would have been exposed 3 years later anyways, but like that was Hannibal Buress's joke.
Totally.
Like, this guy's a fucking rapist. He's telling me to pull up my pants.
Yeah. It kind of takes that because I think like the generations that are too close to somebody's greatness won't touch that person because they mean so much to them. You know, like Eddie Murphy made fun of him on a special. But like for Hannibal Buress, who's like a few generations removed from the impact of Bill Cosby. I mean, obviously legacy, but like the actual living through someone's impact is very different than just kind of like knowing about it. So to be removed from it, it's just like I'm going to clinically approach this from like the guy who's telling me to pick up my pants has raped 80 women.
Yeah, well, speaking of Eddie Murphy, and you had a good idea of rather than like, because like when we did Rodney Dangerfield and we kind of talked about his whole life.
Right.
But you wanted to focus in on the specifically pretty much like the 90s for Chris Rock, like from SNL to Bigger and Blacker, which is really when his career was like that's the height of Chris Rock, clearly.
Yes.
And he went through a lot of, you know, I don't want to say highs and lows because the lows weren't that low.
Yeah.
But you forget a guy like that did go through a period where he was considered a has-been at one point, or at least that's how he says he felt.
Totally, man. Yeah, I mean, like, he's someone who was plucked pretty early, like, super early, kind of put on SNL pretty early. Like, Lorne Michaels had told him, you're going to be the next Eddie Murphy. Yeah. I don't know if he was in a single sketch his first year on SNL. And then Lorne Michaels said to him, I was wrong about that.
Yeah, so he actually toured with Eddie Murphy. When he was like 18, 19 years old. So I think Chris Rock started stand-up when he was like 16 or something crazy.
He's one of those super, super young guys that started stand-up. Because I mean, roll with the new kind of, you know, put him on the map, at least the comedy map a little bit. I've heard it a couple times. I'm just not as familiar with it. But I just remember when he got on SNL, it was like a thing. As a kid, I was like, you know, SNL, they did seem older. And like, I still love Mike Myers and Adam Sandler and like David Spade, all those guys. But they didn't seem hip, you know?
Right.
And then Chris Rock felt hip. He felt cool. Like he would do his weekend update pieces. And I was like, this guy is hilarious. But then they kind of put him in nothing. And like, you're talking about the lows. Like, yeah, that's like one of his lows is like, I'm on Saturday Night Live and it's not going well for me.
Yeah. And then I had to go to In Living Color and it was canceled shortly after.
Right. I had to reprise a famous character I did in a movie on In Living Color and it was, canceled.
So it is, they weren't necessarily that low, but it was interesting to hear him talk about SNL because I didn't really realize. I knew he wasn't a crazy success on Saturday Night Live,
right?
But I didn't realize why necessarily. And when he was talking about it, he kind of discussed how he was pigeonholed. Like he wanted to branch out and do a bunch of different characters. But like the producers on SNL and Lorne Michaels didn't understand most of his characters.
Right.
And then when it was like, oh, you're going to be the black guy in this sketch. Now I get it.
Yeah.
And that's all he was getting on air at that time.
I mean, and if you look at what he's, you know, known for on SNL, it's like, to me, it's I'm Chillin' and The Dark Side with Nat X. And they're like two very stereotypical black characters.
Right.
And like, And he's very funny in both of those, especially I think Nat X holds up as like a sketch. I think that's still hilarious. Like the idea of the white man Cam who like tries to put him in jail every time. And the fact that like his show is only allowed to be 15 minutes because that's all the man allows him to have. Like right. There are a lot of really funny jokes in Nat X. And I'm Chilling has some funny jokes, too. It's just like you look at it now and you go, oh, he was 100% right. You know, where it's like.
And let's not hear Justin. Only... We have a clip of him talking to Marin about it. Want to play that real quick, Justin?
I wanted to be in an environment where I didn't have to really translate the comedy that I wanted to do,
or be the representative of race on a show.
That too. So it's, you know, I had these instances where they wanted me to do certain things at SNL. I was like, no, I'm not doing it.
Like what?
You know, whatever slave sketch or right. You bangy tribesmen or whatever. Where. Not that I thought they were racist. I just thought that if you're the only black face that's going to be seen for an hour and a half, it just doesn't, you know what I mean?
There's got to be more for me to do.
There's got to be more. It's got to be, or another black person.
Yeah. Right.
But you know what I mean? Like,
yeah. So that's pretty much what you were saying, where it's like, oh, he's the black guy. And it was funny, the greatest part about, like, if you look back at SNL, it's funny that people weren't more, you know, there's like, way too much outrage that goes on now.
Sure.
Like back then there probably wasn't enough.
No, totally.
Because sometimes it would be someone that is like, hey, this is just a black person. That's all they have in common. And Chris Rock is now playing them on SNL for some reason.
Totally. No, it's so interesting, especially now with how we view Hollywood and how like they're overreaching for being progressive, in my opinion, in some ways. But they were so behind the ball. It's crazy to be like, this is the same institution, you know, that like, but 25 years ago, asked Chris Rock to be a slave in every sketch. And this year they're like, we need to pull any bit of blackface off any show ever. And I think a lot of that is due to the fact that they are so embarrassed by their own history.
Yeah. Overcorrection. I mean, look at some of the people that are loudest about it, like Sarah Silverman and Jimmy Kimmel. It's like, every time they speak up about it, people post them in,
right,
you know, quote, blackface. And probably is a lot of guilt associated with that, where they're embarrassed they did it or whatever.
I'm sure, man. And those are just the bits that we know of. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
I've been in comedy a little bit. It's like, man, the drafts that are in their folders or like the table read. Like, I'm sure the amount of times Jimmy Kimmel said the N-word in a table read, he's like, I'll never forgive myself.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But yeah, it was very interesting too. Like, I mean, Rock goes from like SNL to In Living Color, which is basically an all black cast except for Jim Carrey. So just the complete opposite.
Yeah. So he was on SNL from 90 to 93. But he kind of made it known that he wanted to go to In Living Color.
Yeah.
He felt like that was the cooler show, like the hipper show. And SNL, like you just said in that clip, wasn't allowing a lot of the stuff that he felt was, you know, that fit that sort of In Living Color vibe. SNL wouldn't allow it on. So basically he got not written out of the show, but like he stopped getting sketches for a while.
Right.
And then eventually got effectively fired.
Yeah.
And he went to In Living Color and it was on for 6 weeks and then canceled.
Man, such a shame too, just because he would have been so funny within the confines of that show. Just that show was so like, I mean, man, Damon Wayans, Tommy Davidson, and it was incredible what they did.
Yeah, it's interesting, though, because when you think about it, let's say he's amazing on In Living Color.
Sure.
That's what we know Chris Rock from.
Totally.
But then we probably never get Bring the Pain, or maybe not even Bigger and Blacker, you know?
Oh, 100%.
Because he's not doing stand-up as much.
I wonder about that just because, like, the way his mind works is so particular to stand-up. Just the way that he sort of, like, takes these... They're not even contrarian. They're just more of like, oh, everybody's looking to the right. What about this thing on the left? And like, that's really the most elemental part of being a stand-up comedian is having this sort of skewed view. And in my opinion, I don't think there's anyone better at doing that and then appealing to a broad audience the way Chris Rock does. There's plenty of people within comedy that have just like taking this contrarian approach or this just like left of center approach. But like, I don't think there's anyone that's done so in a way to get a group of people on board that they don't even know why they're on board.
Right. Well, that's why I was thinking of this earlier, too. And we were talking about, like, influences that you wouldn't necessarily see right on the surface.
Right.
And I don't know how accurate this comparison is, because these guys aren't that far apart in age. Sure. But, like, I see a lot of Chris Rock and Bill Burr, where a lot of Bill Burr's bits are, like, I'm going to say something that you're not going to agree, like society won't agree with.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to explain to you why you should agree with it.
Yeah.
And then by the end of it, you're like, oh, fuck, he is right.
Absolutely. It's even in the way that they build their jokes. I'm of the mind that I think Chris Rock is he might be the best writer, I think, ever in stand up. Just in terms of, like, Burr and him do this great job of, like, just stacking angles on top of angles very quickly, and they keep shifting perspectives quickly, and but within those perspective shifts, their performances are for people who the jokes might be too smart for. So their performances are so good, they get those people on board with these, like, hyper intelligent, like, outside the box ideas. I mean Burr does that so well, and like you're saying, yeah, I think he's like a direct descendant of Chris Rock in that way.
Right. Yeah, for sure. And you know, like you were saying, like, he's so focused on stand up, and I think he realized that. So around 94, he released an album in 91, and then he was in New Jack City in 91 also, I believe. And that was critically acclaimed. So, like, he started touring with Eddie Murphy. You know, he had that taste of, like, fame and fortune. He was in.
Right.
He had an acclaimed role in a movie. He was on SNL. So all of a sudden, Chris Rock, like, while he wasn't crazy famous, he had a little taste of it, you know?
Yeah.
And so then around 94 is when he got his HBO half hour. And he said, like, around that time is when he started to really feel like a has-been. Like, in Living Color failed. Right. SNL, for him, basically failed. And then he realized, like, oh, I haven't been doing stand-up, which is what I want to do.
Right.
So he worked crazy hard. He had an HBO half hour. And then eventually, Bring the Pain, which is, I mean, one of the...
Insane.
Oddly enough, very similar to Eddie Murphy, actually. In that he had two monster specials.
Right. Yep.
And then after that, you can kind of question, like, you know, were his movies great? What audience did he appeal to? Whatever. But, like, he had a decade run where he was the man in comedy.
Dude, I just watched him, you know, in preparation to do this podcast, like, this past week. I haven't seen them, you know, in a long time. And they're like 20 something years old at this point. He says, especially in Bigger and Blacker, he says, like, they're never going to cure AIDS because there's no money in the cure. They're just going to keep there. Eventually, you're going to be like, my AIDS is acting up. And it's like, that's crazy, predictive then to now. Like, you know, he was off on, you know, maybe, like, there'll never be a black vice president. But, like, for the most part, it's like, man, to be that forward thinking and that accurate is incredible. No, like, to what you're saying, like, I was trying to just the magnitude of those specials. It's like, oh, they're relevant to this day. You don't really see that often, especially in comedy. Comedy does not age well. It just won't. It's within the constructs of comedy. It's set up to fail in terms of aging. So, but Chris Rock, he has some bits where you're like, all right, like, we look at men and women a little differently now. But, like, for the most part, like, he's very dead on about the stuff he was saying, especially social commentary stuff, which is amazing. But the magnitude of Bring the Pain, if I could just talk about that for a second.
Yeah.
So when I grew up in North Jersey, and there was MTV. And then for a little while, there was this thing called The Box. And The Box was this music channel where you would call in. You would say, I want to hear a TLC, Waterfalls. They had, like, a code. They would play. They would show the code on the screen. You knew it was coming up. Bring the Pain, the clip about Marion Barry and OJ was... like, it was played nonstop on, like, a music channel.
Oh, really?
Like, this was the biggest. Yeah, I had never, ever seen that before with comedy, where it's like, it's, and it wasn't, you know, like, you know, there's been speculation, like, you know, you have, like, record labels who are ever calling in trying to boost up their own artists. But, like, at some point, it's people that are calling in. And that meant that, you know, I've never seen comedy sort of rival music as something people want to see. Bring the Pain did that with that Marion Barry bit and the OJ bit. And I was like, I couldn't believe you could tell a joke that sort of transcends into you know, music.
Yeah, that's the amazing thing about guys like Chris Rock, and I would put Louis in that category.
Yeah,
and Chappelle now, but like when you look at arena act, typically right. they are either like family friendly, like Jim Gaffigan, where anyone can sure. go see them or whatever, and that was kind of like Steve Martin back in the day,
sure.
or even like you know when Dane Cook was on top. Right. It was, you know, like 15-year-old girls that liked him.
Right. He so was like the Beatles. Like,
you're either, yeah, you're attracting that sort of an audience, or like Dice, where you have kind of right. a gimmick, like the right. nursery rhymes or whatever.
Right.
Chris, guys like Chris Rock and Louis are amazing because they were able to get to that level while being dirty on stage, mm-hmm. having opinions that people won't agree with, like being controversial and still managing to build that sort of an audience.
Yeah, I think it goes back to just they were so thoughtful in their ideas, and they were thoughtful in a way that I don't think anyone had ever heard before, but the ideas weren't so limited where they weren't accessible to people. So like, you know, we're talking about like the black people versus N-words bit. It's like, I mean, that's a bit which I think kind of hasn't aged well to some people.
Oh, to Chris Rock himself.
Yeah. But at the time it was like, man, you see the people erupt in that audience because they're like, I didn't even know I had this thought and you're articulating it. And now I'm so on board because I haven't been able to put a feeling into words and you just did before my eyes. And I think
yeah.
Louis especially is incredible at that. Burr too. I mean, like all those guys, once you're in that like echelon of a way of thinking as a comic, you're just sort of put into that category.
Right.
But he on Bring the Pain, it's like, that's when it was like, oh yeah, he's starting to think on a level that's like, oh, I can make anything I believe funny. And that's really when you see people go from like great comic to legendary comic.
Yeah. Well, you bring up the black people versus N-word bit, and he said, and it's kind of weird because I don't know why he wouldn't do it again anyways, because it was on a special.
Of course.
But I think it became one of those bits that like people would call for.
Yeah.
Hey, do the N-word bit.
Of course.
He said he would never do it again. Well, actually, Justin, real quick, I know everyone knows what we're talking about, but just for context, just play the little clip I sent.
Now, we got a lot of things, a lot of racism going on in the world right now. Who's more racist, black people or white people? Black people. You know why? Because we hate black people, too. Everything white people don't like about black people really don't like about black people. There's some shit going on with black people right now. It's like a civil war going on with black people. And there's two sides. It's black people and there's niggas. And niggas have got to go. Every time black people want to have a good time, ignorant ass niggas fuck it up.
So that obviously is his most famous bit. And that's stopped doing it. And he is actually 100% spot on, because I remember as a kid, people like, you know, like friends of my dad or whatever.
Sure.
I would hear them saying things like, you know, I'm not racist. It's like Chris Rock says, there's two kinds.
I don't think it was like, well, I don't think he foresaw that like Italian uncles were going to be preaching yes. that to the rafters.
Yeah. Yeah. It'd be the rallying cry for Fox News,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah. Yeah. Just reinforcing the idea of one of the good ones.
Yeah. So like, that's where comedy, like you said, doesn't necessarily hold up well, because now yeah. you can just twist that into being whatever you want with like a, you know, 2021 right. perspective yeah. rather than what he meant, you know.
Oh, totally. And then you got to understand too, that's like, that was his biggest bit, you know what I mean? Like that
oh,
was
easily, yeah.
that was a bit in the way that was people were like, this guy is so forward thinking. So yeah. if you want to like see how comedy doesn't age well, that was super forward thinking 25 years ago. And today yeah. people be like, I wouldn't go near saying that.
No. Yeah. But it even like in interviews, he's talked about where like it hurt him, you know, the perception of him in the black community.
Yeah.
Because it gave white people that excuse.
Yes, totally.
And even like the excuse to say it, like, I think it's a funny episode of The Office where they have to like tell Michael he's not allowed to say it, basically.
For sure. Of course.
But that is it's a thing where people felt there like they could have that opinion now and
yes.
say it freely and everything.
Oh, totally,
and I think a lot of his audience was like, hey, Chris, what the fuck are you doing?
Oh, yeah. He even like says that as he's in the special. He's like, a lot of people, you know, you're going to boo, you're going to this, you're going to that. But like, yeah, no, my mom heard that and was like, I've been saying this for years.
He's so right.
Yeah, I was just like, this might not be good. I've heard her say a lot of things.
Mom said many things for you.
Yeah. Jesus. Oh no. His audience
never leading
is gonna
to policy changes.
Yeah, it's gonna be all women named Joanne and Angela.
Yeah. So the other interesting thing, and I mean, you can kind of take this from all the specials, and I'm curious your thoughts on this. Have you ever seen him just like just being around in New York, where like he works on his act when he comes into like the Cellar or the Stand or wherever he goes there?
Yes, years ago. I this was actually before I started doing comedy, because I lived in North Jersey. We would go to the Cellar in the summer, like a bunch of friends of us. He dropped in to do an hour at the Cellar, and he, you know, his like famous process of like not really turning on the performance, just letting the writing speak for itself, so he could see what jokes work and don't work. He told a joke. I don't think I've ever seen anyone get this big of a reaction. I've never heard him do it in any specials. He told a joke about how he was in Europe and he was like watching German porn, and he was like, he called German porn a Rodney King beating with dicks, and the place erupted. He's never even put that on anything. I remember that throwaway joke from Chris Rock. But it was cool. It was cool to watch that happen. And to watch him just go through the writing, because weirdly enough, man, that's how I always saw him. Like the performance to me felt like he had to do this in order to like sort of survive up there or gain such a big following. And that's not, you know, you should perform the hell out of your jokes, and like he does. But it always, for me, what stuck with me about him was like, oh, this guy is a writer first and foremost. Like,
right. So that was the interesting thing about his process, where I want to play two clips real quick, just because, sure, like, I was fascinated by it. First, Justin, bring up the clip from Born Suspect. This is from his first album, where he hadn't perfected that, like, Chris Rock tone yet.
Right.
And my understanding is, like, this is kind of what he sounds like when he's just, you know, at the Comedy Cellar working his shit out.
Nicest part of the South, for sure, man. It's like the only part of the South you go, like, when I go to, nobody goes, man, I wish you could take me back to New York with you. You go to, like, Mississippi, motherfuckers be hiding in your car and shit.
So it's funny to hear him, it's funny to hear that sort of, like, laid back. And then I was very surprised when I heard, like, that's pretty much how he sounds, kind of, where he's just casually talking.
Yes.
And he's like, you know, because you're so used to, like, but I understand. Like,
totally, man.
Like, the impression of Chris Rock, basically, that he's doing.
Of course. I don't think people get how hard it is to sell comedy club crowds on ideas, smart ideas that they might not necessarily be on board with. You have to fool them. You're like, that part of the job is you're like a salesman, and like you're selling what you hold dear, which is like these things that you cultivated and worked on and you believe in. So you want them to get across. It's just a matter of salesmanship. And he figured out how to do that. And I think like people would look at that and go like, this is ridiculous. This is over the top. He's using this insane voice. But it's like, no, man, you actually have to do that in order to get these people on board who just kind of came out to see anybody, you know?
Yeah. So this is, again, him on Marin talking about like his process of doing that. And I mean, you kind of gave your thoughts, but I'm just curious, like, I'm interested in this mentality. Like, it fascinated me when I heard him talking about his preparation and everything. So let's hear that real quick.
Now let's talk about the issue of you know, Chris Rock running material in a small club versus Chris Rock, you know, going on stage at an arena. Because I've seen you go on stage and you almost sleep through some jokes. Like, I've seen you with new jokes where you won't put any inflection on them. You'll literally just say them. And in my mind, I think it's just to see the whether the joke as it is written.
Yes, it's like, I want to believe that the joke,
without you juicing it,
will kill no matter what. That this act could be done behind a curtain.
Right. So you know that you're doing that on purpose.
I'm doing, yeah. So there's a part of me like,
so you'll go up there and risk tanking.
It's like, come on. There's no tanking. It's just, I mean, you know, if I go to,
So, I mean, that's what I'm curious about is like,
yeah.
I wonder if obviously it's worked for Chris Rock, but I don't know if I totally agree with that in the sense of like, I think his inflection is part of the joke.
It is.
You know what I mean? Like part of the reason you're laughing is because the way it's delivered. So it's not the same if you're just kind of casually talking through it rather than having the same passion you do when you're in, you know, Madison Square Garden.
Totally. But you can, even if you get, if he gets a trickle of laughter, you could go, oh, there's something here. But if you get right. nothing from just like sort of a computer generated speech of the joke, then you're like, there's zero here. Cause it's also, this is a really smart thing to do because like when comics get so big, you have your audience. So they're just going to laugh at anything you do. I think, you know, like you heard Steve Martin talk about that. And I think yeah. when you get to Chris Rock's level and when you're so funny in a unique way as a performer, the crowd's going to go with you on anything. So it's like you almost have to handicap your jokes as much as you can to know if they're actually good because eventually you can't get a real read on them anymore. Wherever right. you show up, an audience is like, I'm so excited that you're here. So whatever you're going to say, they're going to buy.
Yeah, it's not even laughing. They're just cheering. Like you're exactly. getting a standing ovation before you tell a joke.
And how many comics have you seen, like, you know, that you can name that got humongous and couldn't escape that fate? Because it's like, yeah, you get lazy. Of course you do. You're in front of an arena that adores you. Like,
yeah, or not even lazy, but maybe like naive in the sense right. that everyone yeah. in your world is telling you how great that is.
Exactly.
Like I thought, I mean, Chappelle's probably my favorite comedian ever.
Sure.
And there were a few jokes in this last special. I walked out of work. I was so angry at them. But there were a couple jokes in the closer where I was like, that feels like something everyone has told Chappelle is funny.
Yeah.
But 20 years ago, I don't think Chappelle would have had that in his act.
100%, man. It's just a matter of fame. But I think taking those measures, whether Chris Rock do that or not, I kind of think is the only way to do it. Because I agree with you. I think that's actually a fair criticism of Chappelle's last special, just that point alone.
Right. Yeah, no, and you know, well, Chappelle also got to, not to go off on a tangent, like he refers to himself as the greatest ever in that special, where it's like he is, but as a comic, you're not supposed to know that.
You
know?
No, man, you're supposed to be the underdog.
Right, yeah.
You're supposed to be this guy that people root for. It's hard to yeah. do that when you're wearing your own brand of clothing.
C on your chest. Yeah.
right. But also, I mean, like, look, that guy, he's incredibly funny in a way that is, I don't even think Chris Rock. Like, he's just like, only Richard Pryor to me maybe is as naturally gifted or seemingly so effortless as Chappelle is.
Yeah. Well, to bring it back to Chris Rock, I would say he is the one guy that I can think of other than, again, to tie it back to Bill Burr, and maybe George Carlin.
Sure.
But other than that, like you see these guys like Eddie Murphy goes off and does movies. Right. Steve Martin goes off and does movies. Chappelle now definitely has an ego on him. Kevin yeah. Hart certainly like Kevin Hart is like a brand rather than a stand-up. You know what I mean?
Yeah, he's a production company in a person.
Yeah. But Chris Rock, Carlin, and Louis are the guys that stand out to me as completely being comics and Seinfeld in a way where I,
sure,
you know,
I
don't necessarily
that.
Love all of Seinfeld's stand-up, same. But like he is a comic through and through, you know?
Yeah. I think it's a thought process. I don't know that I've ever been actually been able to articulate the feeling that I get. You just kind of know when you see it of like, oh, this guy thinks like a comedian, like his view of the world is just slightly off, but that's the only way he can be. And you, right. and it's just like, Carlin, Louis, Chris Rock, the names you mentioned, they have it in its pure form. And I think that's why they're so successful and they're so skilled as comedians is because like they're mentally approaching the world in a way of a stand-up, specifically of a stand-up comedian. So it's like I don't think they could do anything else or they'll not do anything else as well just because like it takes so much – I mean – effort, sure, but just like natural inclination to think that way, and you either kind of have it or you don't.
Yeah. So before we get to Bigger and Blacker, the thing sure. I forget about, and it seems like society forgot about this, like it's very underrated, was the Chris Rock show.
Oh my God, I'm glad, so glad you mentioned
after
it.
The success of Bring the Pain, He got the Chris Rock show on HBO, which I always... So I'm a little younger than you. I was born in 91. Oh, so I have no real memory of the Chris Rock show at all.
Oh, man. The Chris Rock show was... it won't ever get its due for what it was. The Chris Rock show had a sketch I still think about all the time. It was so silly, but it was so funny. It was Mario Joyner was trying to hail a cab in New York. And this was at a time where, like, it was being brought up how hard it was for black men to get cabs in New York. And he was like, I just don't know. I can't get a cab. But you only saw him from, like, the neck up. And then the camera panned, and he was completely naked. And it was very, very silly as a sketch. But the whole thing was this premise that, like, ah, no, man, it's because you're nude in the streets. But he would still be like, it's hard for a black man to get a cab. And I was like, man, that's so, so funny. Chris Rock show was great.
Yeah, so that's, like, and sometimes old sketches from that show pop up. So, again, I thought it was, like, a sketch show. I didn't realize it was, like, essentially what Bill Maher does on HBO now, where it was, like, political commentary and interviews and that sort of thing, where I find that that would be, like, the one, I don't know the word I'm looking for, but I wish that lasted longer, because I'd be so curious to hear Chris Rock in that type of format now, like, with everything that's going on now in the world.
Yeah, it was, I would say it was, like, a, you know, a little bit ahead of its time as, like, a variety show. In terms of the commentary that it was trying to make.
Some technical difficulties there, but we're back, hopefully. Yeah,
my bad.
So, yeah, I, like, to your, we were talking about the Chris Rock show. And it is, like, just with the shit that's gone on in the last couple of years, like, I, like, we were talking about his social commentary just in Bring the Pain alone. Like, I don't know that you think of, like, a kid now wouldn't think of Chris Rock as this brilliant social commentator, I don't think. And I feel like that's kind of a shame because, you know, you have to hear from everyone on Twitter and shit now, yet we don't get that commentary from a guy like Chris Rock, which is a little unfortunate.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I can't speak to his personal life or as to why, but it is just because he was like, I always saw him as a pretty measured voice, even though, like, you can get, you know, sort of a distracted by the, like, gregarious performance, but I actually think the stances he took were, like, fair. I mean, they're, you know, they're liberal, but they were, like, fairly conservative stances, and they were a little bit, like, critical of, like, areas that you weren't necessarily supposed to be critical of, but done in a way that was smart, not just hot takey. And that's, I think, what's really lacking from today's stand-up is, like, that measured voice.
Yeah, completely. And I think the reason we probably, well, I have no idea, but my guess would be the reason we don't hear it from a guy like Chris Rock as much is because it's not real. No one wants it. Like, the networks don't want that.
Oh, totally.
You know what I mean? Like, Comedy Central is not going to put Chris Rock on to tell the truth, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, they, it's, you know, and I bet what he would say would be grounded and also slightly forward thinking. But they go under this assumption that, like, the next wave of ideas needs to come in. But lots of times that next wave, they don't really have ideas yet. You know, like, you know, like, Chris Rock was pretty young, obviously, when he did Bring the Pain. I think he's like, I don't even know if he's 30 at that point.
I think he was exactly 30 because he was 25 when he got on SNL.
Okay. But he had been doing stand-up since he was like 16. So he had, like, cultivated a voice. But also, man, even the way he performs, he says a punchline on Bring the Pain. I forget the punchline. But, like, he literally, like, he smacks the mic in a way that, like, a rapper would, like, at a show. Yeah. And it was like, no, he's after something with these jokes. Like, this is hunger that's out there.
Well, do you know I didn't know this until I was researching for this episode. I guess he had, like, some sort of, not record deal, but, like, he started as a rapper, basically.
Oh, I didn't know
and
that.
And made, like, demo tapes and shit.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that makes a lot of his punchlines. I mean, he's very famous for rhyming punchlines that do very, very well. But his performance is, like, it's joyful, but it's also, it's aggressive, for sure. Like, in a way that, like, you don't see too often in comedy.
Right.
You know what's funny is,
and this is a thing where, like, podcasts have almost started to ruin stand-up because by breaking down... This show is terrible for stand-up because by breaking it down so much, it almost, like, dilutes what it is. But I heard Joe List talk about this once on Tuesdays with Stories, where, like, when List started opening for Louis,
right?
Louis obviously is friends with Rock, And Joe List asked Louis, he's like, do you understand? He's like, I've been a Chris Rock fan for years. And he has some punchline where he says, for a white man, the sky's the limit. For a black man, the limit's the sky.
Yeah.
And Joe List goes, that doesn't make any sense. Like, what does he mean by that? So they called Chris Rock and asked him about it. And Chris Rock goes, yeah, no, it's just the cadence. Like, the cadence is funny.
Yeah. It's just like, that's like a very funny turn of phrase.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I mean, people like, go,
and yeah. It's funny that he picked up on that because you wouldn't think anything of it. You're like, oh, that's hilarious. Yeah. But to then dissect it, you're like, oh, it doesn't mean anything. It's just funny.
Yeah. Yeah. No, exactly. It's just funny. But yeah, no, that line gets like the audience erupts from that line. For whatever reason, like that's like one of those times where like, I think you mentioned him, like, you know, his acting or whatever. That's one of those times where I'm like, I didn't need the words so much as like the attitude kind of sold me on, I think what you're trying to say in that turn of phrase. But no, I don't know, man. I think like dissecting stand up like this, you know, it takes a little bit of the fun out, sure, but but it does like show you the amount of effort that goes into just like writing a joke, let alone an hour of them.
Well, that was my logic with the reason I wanted to start the show is A, obviously, because I'm such a big stand up fan,
right.
But like, there is this type of show breaking down, you know, every other art form, movies, TV, music, whatever. And I kind of realized, like, for whatever reason, stand-up doesn't get that respect. Like, we were talking about hecklers a few weeks ago. And just the idea that, like, you would never go to a play and be like, this sucks. Like, you would never yell out at any other type of performance. So it's weird that people feel so comfortable doing it in comedy.
Yeah, I think it's because comedy kind of like presents itself in this limbo, you know, as like, you know, to us, we're like, yeah, it's art and it's a craft. But then it's also like we want to come across as everyman, salt of the earth kind of people. And you're talking to people, you know, like it is a monologue, but like you are looking people in the eye and talking to them. It's not like music where you're like, I'm singing a song. You're kind of removed from this. Right. Like you're in with comedy. It's like you're a part of this. You're a part of this every second. Every second that you laugh, you're now a part of this. Like you're moving in unison. And so I think to put yourself in another place, like you almost can't if you want it to go well. So because of that, like an audience sees comedy as this like and the other thing too is like when you do it really well, it's supposed to seem effortless. That's the problem
right.
with comedy.
Right,
it's like,
right.
Man, when you do it well, people go, I think I could do that. And like you don't know how much work it took to get to that place for you to believe that you could do it.
Right. So if you had to choose, Bring the Pain or Bigger and Blacker?
I think I was always, when I grew up, I was Bring the Pain. But listening to them since, you know, I would pick Bigger and Blacker. I just think it's like it's there as a whole more than I think Bring the Pain. And I think some of the ideas are more mature. And like there's instances where like he can make anything. He can make whatever he wants to talk about funny on Bring the Pain. But Bigger and Blacker, he can pull anything out of the ether and make it funny. It doesn't matter how broad the idea is. Like one of my, I think, favorite jokes, I don't know if it's like a favorite joke, I'm just like more impressed, is on Bigger and Blacker where he's talking about like the plight of Native Americans and how like nobody's had it harder than them. And it's like, yeah, everybody knows that. That's just the thought that everybody knows. So I remember watching him be like, how are you going to make this funny? But he makes it funny because of the writing where he goes, I've seen a polar bear ride a tricycle. I've never seen two Native Americans together. And it's like, that's so funny. But it's like, you had to write the shit out of that. You know what I mean? To get to like, how do I just not make this obvious funny? And like, I was
and
like,
thinking, is
that
polar bear the right word? Like the amount of shit he probably tried there.
Right. And just like the simple concept of two Native Americans. I was like, that is like a masterstroke to me.
Right. My first takeaway, and just kind of showing how much things have changed in the last 20 years, is do you remember when a couple years ago when someone uploaded Louis C.K.'s set? He was at like Governor's in Long Island.
Oh, sure.
Or something.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
And he got in trouble. People attacked him for the Parkland bit he did.
Right.
And that was at an illegally recorded event where he was working on a joke. Chris Rock opened Bigger and Blacker with a Columbine joke.
Oh,
it was
man.
The first
yeah.
thing he said when he gets on stage is making fun of Columbine, which just happened.
Yeah,
which is why.
Yeah.
So I think we were just so much more accepting of allowing comedy to you know, make light of tragedy back then.
Yeah, but I also I think there's a little nuance to that situation where it's like Louis was coming off the heels of a scandal that tanked his career.
Yeah.
And then so he was already being vilified. So like the public just wanted another reason to hate him.
Right,
and like
right.
He's up there being like, I don't know, I think these Parkland kids are assholes. And they're just like, see, we told you this guy is a monster. But
right.
With Chris Rock, it was like he was almost, I think Bring the Pain kind of, he was looked at as like, this guy is going to intelligently and hilariously tell us about the world.
Yes.
So for him to open with, I think for him to open with school shooting is probably him being like, hey, what, like, how do I get out there the hardest and the most, like, let these people know this is what they're in store for about an hour. And he also just has that, the takeaway that nobody had, which was he's the best at, here is what was in front of everybody's face. Here's the simplest premise. And I'm just going to show everybody what you guys missed. And just the idea of like, whatever happened to crazy. Why are we overthinking it? And it was just like,
right. Yeah,
man, that's beautiful. That's, you're right.
Yeah. Yeah. And that it was funny because when I was watching it, I was like, and you're probably right about the difference between Bring the Pain and Bigger and Blacker. Because when I was watching Bring the Pain, I was like, this is funny.
Yeah.
I was watching Bigger and Blacker, I was like, wow. Like, I couldn't believe some of the shit he was doing and how well it held up, considering if you go back and watch a special from 25 years ago, like even try to tell a kid now.
Yeah.
About George Carlin,
right?
Or Eddie Murphy, like tell a kid now about Raw.
Yeah,
I mean the first track, you lose them.
Dude, Bullet Control on Bigger and Blacker is the funniest take
Brilliant.
On gun control
Brilliant.
To this day, and that's 25 years ago. And I honestly listen to that bit and go, I don't know why this wouldn't work in real life.
I think that all the time.
I'm like,
bullets
this
are $5,000.
A perfect idea. That bit is, I think it's all time. I think the best bit ever. Just because, like, the concept alone is this brilliant concept. But then he has three separate angles. Like, anyone would have just been happy with, like, I can't believe I thought of this concept. But then he adds three different perspectives of, like, the guy who has to get the bullet back, the guy who, like, bullets have to be on layaway. He has three separate unbelievable angles, which means, like, yeah, he went through probably, like, 15 or 20 of those until he got to those three. And that's on the heels of this like idea that I really think would change the world if implemented by Congress.
but really is brilliant. And
yeah.
It's funny because like it might be because of my age where time wise, I kind of just missed him when
right.
he was at his peak.
Yeah.
You know, but like then when I think about it and when I was preparing for this episode, he has, minimum. Three of the greatest bits of all time in
totally.
Those two specials.
Yes, 100%. And like he just was so smart. I don't even know how much of you know doing this, like him, not you, but like where it's like he like just knew like even in Bring the Pain where he's like, I'm not saying I would have killed her, but I understand. Like
I understand
that
yeah.
phrase. Like it's just like it's like man, everyone just knows that phrase.
Yeah.
And like. Yeah, we were talking earlier about Bring the Pain. Yeah, Bring the Pain, you could still see he was like, he was shedding like being a young comic where you're just kind of talking about, you know, you're funny, but you're not really talking about anything. Like he is
right.
like, he's like a full bit about pork and like crack where you're like, yeah, you're not going to do that on Bigger and Blacker. And if
right.
you do, there's going to be like real things behind it that you're saying.
Right. Well, that pretty much wraps up Chris Rock from SNL to Bigger and Blacker. And on it, like, I don't know. Some of his stand up, obviously he never did anything as good as those two specials,
right.
but I do think there is some stuff like in Tambourine that I genuinely
oh, totally.
Found funny and honest. And like the way he spoke about his divorce, like I kind of couldn't believe it. I was like, wow, that's maybe the most honest I've seen a guy on stage because
yeah.
he's talking about something that obviously like hurt his family life, you know, not just
totally.
his persona or whatever.
Yeah. And it was such a unique, he was being so honest, and it was such a unique way that like a relationship can go sour when he kind of talked about his like porn addiction, which was like that was fascinating to hear. Just as like I don't think I've ever heard that from a friend, let alone
right,
right. Chris Rock. You know?
Right. All right, Anthony. Well, thank you very much for coming on, man. You can
sure
see
do.
Anthony in Justin said you're going to be in Foxborough as well. Do you know about
oh,
this?
Yeah. So I'm January 28th and 29th.
I'm going to be doing, I'll be at the Comedy Scene in Foxborough. Those will just be stand-up sets. So if you're someone who's like, I don't feel like being moved, I just want to laugh, come out to those shows.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so you have an option. You can see Anthony at Laugh Boston work on his one-man show, which I would recommend. I would recommend checking out both. Because they're, I mean, they're not that far. If you're living around like where I am, you can go see both. It's very easy. So check out Anthony in Foxborough and Laugh Boston, end of January. And make sure you follow him on social media and everything. Anthony, thanks so much for coming on, man.
Dude, great talking to you, Mike.
All right, buddy. We'll see you next time on Why You Laugh.